So, this is my first visit to London, actually, and I've added a couple of days to my stay, and it's really a beautiful city, really, it is. I saw some great buildings, some great culture. I didn't go up the London Eye, to be honest, because I'm a bit afraid of heights. For me, the underground escalators were high enough, actually. So, okay, so let's get started. I will be talking about how you can secure your serverless applications in Azure in the next hour. And I'm going to do this using a scenario. So, before we start, a little bit about me. My name is Sjoukje Zaal. I work for Capgemini in the Netherlands as a cloud solution architect, and I'm also an Azure MVP. If you want to contact me, my Twitter handle is on the screen. You can also take a look at my blog if you're interested in my articles as well. So, the agenda. We're going to kick off with what and why. I'm going to do a very brief introduction to serverless applications because I know that everyone kind of knows what it is right now. I'm going to talk to you about the scenario that we are going to use for this presentation and for the demos. Then we're going to look at how you can secure your functions, your Azure functions, and what capabilities there are to secure that. Then we're going to look at how you can secure your logic apps and what the best practices are. And I have a demo about that as well. Last, we're going to look at the Azure AD. We're going to register an application in Azure AD. And we're going to use the Microsoft Graph and the Azure AD application from our logic app to create some users. And at last, we're going to look at the monitoring capabilities. And I will show you a couple of demos about that as well. So, serverless. What is serverless? Actually, it's an empty rack, no servers at all. Jeff Holland took a great picture about that, I think about a year ago. There are no servers anymore, no infrastructure. But this doesn't make it actually simpler or much easier to create your applications. Because it is serverless, it's more related to microservice-based architecture. And that means that you have to go and to split up your applications in smaller pieces to create your services or your actual applications. They are built in smaller functions. And that doesn't make it much easier for developers because you're going to divide your logical steps and your code into different pieces and maybe and mostly different resources and services in Azure as well. So Microsoft has a bunch of services in their offering. We're going to look at the functions and the key vault in this presentation mostly. We're going to look at logic apps and we're going to use a bit of Azure storage in this example as well. But Microsoft has more to offer, like Event Grid or Event Hubs. If you really have a lot of events for demanding applications globally, worldwide, you can take a look at Event Grid and Event Hubs as well. Also, for IoT applications, it is a good service. Azure Search is one of the newer services that they have to offer, and you can incorporate that as a search solution in your application as well. So it's really, I really recommend to take a look at that someday. Okay, besides the resources and the services that Azure has to offer, there is also a architecture, and that has more to do with how do you develop your applications, what platform do you use, are you going to use access and security control, because that's a part of it as well, secure your serverless applications. It's not that it is secure out of the box when you put it in the cloud. There are a bunch of analytics capabilities and features which I'm going to show in the last step as well. IoT application, I briefly named that as well. And of course, your IDE support and also your CI/CD pipelines and your monitoring. very important for creating secure solutions. But let's talk about that later. So why should you use serverless applications? Because it's fully managed. There are no servers anymore. Fully managed by Azure. You don't have to maintain any infrastructure for it. This also speeds up the time to market and the development time as well, because you only have to look at the code that you create and you don't have to worry about anything else anymore. Because there are no operational costs anymore, this will also reduce the costs for your applications as well. Also, if you use the consumption-based models in Azure, I ran my demo for about, 20,000 times, and it cost me about €4 or something like that. So it's extremely cost-effective. Okay, our current scenario is really a very complicated application that they've created at Contasso. It consists of a logic app which is going to call out to Azure AD and create an external user. But the current solution that they have created is just a logic app which directly connects to Azure AD using the graph. And the security department, they have audited this application, and their conclusion was that it is not secure enough to go into production. Things have to change. And this, what this application basically does, it's been called by a different application or a service by a Contasso user, a Contasso employee, which is present inside of Azure AD. And that Contasso employee is going to create an external user inside of Azure AD because they want their marketing campaign, they want to collaborate with their marketing campaign with others. So external users are going to be added to Azure AD and they're going to be added to a marketing application later. So let's take a look at what the security department discovered. So all the users who had an access, a link to that logic apps, can access it. It's not only for Azure AD users from Contasso. If you just obtain the link with the shared access signature, you can access that application. That also means that it can be accessed by all types of applications and by all types of users. And that's not secure enough as well. It only needs to be accessed by the sample application. They used an Azure AD application for registering the external users, and the tenant ID, the application ID, and the app secret, they were hard-coded inside of the logic app. Not secure enough. And there was no monitoring set up for this application, not at all. So if anything goes wrong, the admins of Contasso will not know what the error is and if people are going to access their applications when they are not allowed to. So our future scenario is going to be a bit different. We are going to use an Azure function to start with, and we're going to use that Azure function because we can enable authentication and authorization for it. So we can only allow Azure AD users to access that function. This is not possible with logic apps out of the box. If you use an Azure function and you want to connect to a logic app later on from your Azure function, a best practice is to put a queue in the middle of it. So first, create a queue, add a message to the queue, and let the logic app trigger that queue. So the next step is to infect that logic app, and we're going to stick with that logic app because it has a lot of connectors out of the box. We want to connect to an Azure Key Vault. We want to use manage identities. A logic app has a lot of connectors. Just use it and connect to it. So that logic app is going to connect to our Azure AD application using the Microsoft Graph. So that's what we're going to create. And we're using that Microsoft Graph to create the external user, an Azure B2B user, inside of the Azure AD tenant. Okay, let's get started. So what technical building blocks are we going to use for this application? We're going to use the Azure functions with the authentication and authorization capabilities. We're going to use managed identities to connect to other Azure resources. We're going to use the Azure AD and the Microsoft Graph again to create users inside of our Azure B2B tenant securely. And we're going to use the Azure Key Vault to store the credentials to our Azure AD tenant and to our applications. So let's start with the first step. In the first step, we're going to create that Azure function and we're going to use that storage queue to create a message from our code in our Azure function. So before we start, why are we going to use an Azure function for this and not the Logic app like in the first solution that they've created? Because functions, they can be secured out of the box and Logic apps can't. If you want to secure a Logic app, you have to create an API management tool around it. So you have to deploy API management to restrict access to your Logic app. That's not the most cost-effective and the most simple way to secure your application. That's why we're going to look at that function. And the other thing, if you use functions, you can also select a different app service plan. Out of the box, it selects the consumption service plan. But if you want a different consumption, a different app service plan, you can create or select different service plans as well. And that is going to add a couple of additional things, like custom SSL and a custom domain name if that's required. Okay, so what does the Azure function has to offer? For authentication, you can authenticate it with Azure Active Directory. That's what we're going to use for our scenario. You can also use Microsoft accounts for it, like personal accounts, and a couple of social media accounts like Facebook, Google, and Twitter. There are a couple of extra options that you can use as well, like an application gateway, but that's more if you want to go infrastructure, and I think most production environments will already have an application gateway, but this doesn't give you the ability to only give access to Azure AD users. API management, you can use that one as well, of course. And for monitoring capabilities, application insights. And I recommend that you always enable this. You have to do this when you create your function in the portal or using Visual Studio. Okay, first demo. Let's secure our function. So, to the Azure portal, is it readable? Shall I zoom a bit?
No.
Zoom, yeah? Like this?
One more?
Yeah? Okay, great. I already created a resource group for this, and the first step is to create that message queue. So let's briefly look at that. I created a message queue in here, which is basically a storage account with a queue in it. Nothing much. And I've added an initialize queue to this. Okay, so we now have that queue in place, and now we can create our Azure function to connect to this queue. So I've created a function just to initialize this workflow. That's why it's called initialize function. Okay, let's first look at the integration for this function because we want to connect it to our queue as an output. So you go to integrate in the left. And I use the basic HTTP trigger for this. So any application can call this function. So I've created a output item in here. And if you select that one, if you want to create a new one, just click new output, and then you can click through it and select the output that is suitable for your application. So I connect it to that message queue. That's the first step. When you select new, you can connect to that message queue. You have to provide the queue name in here. Don't leave the default because you will get an error when you save it. And the message queue parameter, I left the default value in here. So if you now go back to that HTTP trigger, you will see that I have added the system security claims in here. And this one, this library, is needed if you want to use the claims principle in here. And I will dive in this further a bit later. But what it basically does, it gets a request. And that request consists of a first name, a last name, and an email address, which are basically the values for our external user that we want to create in Azure AD B2B. Then I put the request in a string, get out that values, and I put it on the queue. So this is that parameter that we created. We add the first name, the last name, and the email address to the queue with a semicolon in between. What I also do is I'm going to iterate through that claims principle object. And if you want to read out the claims of the logged in user, so the user that is logged into Azure AD when it creates the request, you just simply put this in the header and you can read out that claims by using that system security claims DLL inside of it. So I'm going to iterate through all the claims and I'm going to log that information to log analytics. At last, I will log another value to log analytics as well that the request is created. So now we have our Azure function, which creates a queue item with the values that are passed on to the request. So the next step is that we need to enable security for this. And for that, you have to go to the initialize function part. And in the top, click on platform features. And under networking, you can select authentication and authorization. So it will be off when you create your function, so turn it on. In here, select log in with Azure Active Directory. You see that you can use the other providers as well, identity providers in here. And then click on Azure Active Directory. And there are two ways to configure this. There is an express way, and this will automatically registers an Azure AD application in your Azure AD tenant. And you can also do that manually and provide the values. So I've used the express way, then it creates an Azure AD app which exactly the same name as your function. And that's basically it. If you click OK in here and you click Save, now your function is Azure AD secured. There is one more thing that you need to do for this, because automatically it adds a shared access signature to your function. If you don't switch to anonymous, you have to use that SAS key to call that function. And we don't want, if we leave this one enabled, we have to incorporate that SAS key and log in with our Azure AD credentials as well. So we need to turn that one off. And you can do this back at integrate. It took me a while before I found out where it was. And here you can set the authorization level. So by default, it's set to function. And you have to set this one to anonymous. So now you don't have to add that SAS key to your request. Okay, so now we have our function. It's ready. So let's take a let's do a test. The mouse stops. Okay. Let me get the URL. Okay. So I'm going to call this function. And I'm going to pass on a couple of parameters. My mouse stops. That's very handy. Okay. Passing on the parameters, and now you will see we need to authorize, authenticate to Azure AD. So let's add the email address, and I will need to confirm this on my phone. Okay. There you go. We now added our request. This is the message that is added to our queue. A bit different, but and this is our response, which we get from our function. Sorry. Okay. So that's it for this first demo. So a quick recap. First, we created a message queue to store the new requests. And then you can create your function afterwards. You enable authentication and authorization for your function. You need to change the authorization level for your function to anonymous. And at last, we created a request using Azure AD with an Azure AD registered user. And we passed on the claims principle values to that as well. And I will show you that because I forgot that step actually. But let's go back to the Azure portal. You will see if you go to monitor in here. Let's wait a bit. In here, you will see that if you click on that last request, you will see that all the claims, I think it's below here, all the claims are logged in here as well. So these claims, you can use these claims for authorization purposes. Maybe you want your function only to do some logic when a admin is logged in, or maybe when a normal user is logged in. This is all logged into Log Analytics. So you can use this by only adding that claims principle in your header of your requests. So that's it for the logic app, for the function, sorry. Let's go to the next step. Let's create our logic app and let's secure that logic app. And we're going to use a couple of features for this. And there are some other options for this, for securing your logic apps as well. You can also use that application gateway, which is precisely the same as when you use it for your Azure function. You cannot use Azure AD authentication using the web application firewall. You can also use API management for this as well, if you want to. And for authentication, you can use the Azure AD graph in your code, in your logic app, not to request that logic app. There are some more security features and capabilities as well. The integration service environment, which uses a express route underneath, just like the app service environment. But it's quite a cost, quite some costs come with that. So I will only recommend this for real corporate environments, real production environments. And it also has a secure output feature, and I will show you that later on. If you enable this inside of your Azure Logic app, Like for instance, when you retrieve values from a key vault, if you enable this, then those values will not be locked inside of Azure. So they will never be visible to the user. So we're going to use managed identities for this because for our scenario, we only want that logic app to access the message queue. We don't want any other applications to access that message queue. That was one of the requirements, the security requirements for our audit. Only connect with the application that is that needs to connect to that service. What managed identities also does, it keeps your credentials secure. You don't have to use credentials anymore. You just connect a managed identity to your service. You create a managed identity for your Azure resource, and you just connect to another service. And Azure will handle all the credentials for you. There are two types of managed identities that you can create, a user assigned and a system assigned. A system assigned is always bound to your Azure resource. So if you remove that resource, like for instance a logic app, and you remove that resource, then the managed identity will be deleted automatically as well. You can create a user assigned managed identity. So you create that one manually inside of Azure AD. And this one doesn't depend on the Azure resource. So you can reuse that identity for multiple resources or for multiple requirements. For this demo, we're going to create a system assigned managed identity because I want it to be bound to that logic app. And I only want that logic app to use that identity and no other applications. What the managed identity does underneath, it Azure connects to a service, and that service will also handle the tokens for you. So when Azure AD issues a token to you and it is not valid anymore, then that server will automatically request a new token. So what we're also going to do is we're going to use a Azure Key Vault for this because we don't want our tenant ID, our app ID, and our app secret to be hard-coded in our logic app anymore. So we're going to store that values safely inside of Azure Key Vault, and we're going to request that values in our logic app. And you can use that Key Vault for a number of things, for key management, but also for certificates. You can use that one as well. And you can use it for your hardware security requirements as well. So let's take a look at our logic app. I already created that one because it will take too much time otherwise. Okay, a logic app. Now let me first show you the managed identity. Here. In the logic app settings, if you go in the left menu under settings, you see identity. So if you want to create a managed identity for this logic app, click here. Identity, just turn it on. And what Azure does, it registers that application inside of Azure AD at that moment. And it will give the permissions to read the user profile to it automatically as well. So that's all there is to create a managed identity for your service. Just enable it. So what we need to do in here also is add that managed identity to our Key Vault and to our message queue because we need that identity to retrieve those values. So for this, let's go back to our message queue for this. And in here, if you go to access control, you can check the access of your logic app. It will use the out-of-the-box name. And as you can see, the create external user is in here. So that's it for the message queue. We can now select that message queue from our logic apps. And for the key vault, I did it a bit different. I created an access policy in there. So if you go in your Key Vault settings and you go to Access Policies under Settings, you will see that that application also has access to that Key Vault. And you need to select two permissions for this. You always need to select List and you need to select Get. So this is basically enough to read values from the Azure Key Vault. Not to store values, then you have to select the create or the update in here, but to retrieve values, this is enough. So now we are prepared to connect to our different services. So let's go back to our Logic app. Okay, let's click on Edit. And let's look at the first part of this. You start this Logic app with a queue trigger. And you connect it to the initialize queue for this. And then we need to retrieve those values from the queue. And for this, I'm going to create an array which reads out that queue message and is going to split it up based on the semicolon. It's going to look at the message text and it's going to split it up. Next, we're going to read out that variables to set our first name, our last name, and our email address. Okay, let's stop here because the rest of the values are going to be are coming from our Azure AD application, and we first need to register that one. So let's go back to our presentation. So what we now did, first you create that system assigned manager identity and you add that to your Key Vault and your message queue. You connect the queue with that managed identity, you connect to the queue, and then you create that new Logic app using the queue trigger, and you can retrieve that queue message and parse it to different variables to use it later on in your Logic app. So the next step, this is the actual step where we're going to create that Azure AD B2B user, that external user, and for this, we're going to create or register an application inside of Azure AD. So what it basically is, it's also called a service principle in Azure AD or in Azure. And Azure uses it for all different sorts of connections and authentications. The managed identity, in fact, is also an Azure AD registration. So it uses that for that as well. And underneath it uses OAuth 2.0, the authorization framework. And you can set different permissions for this. You can set app permissions, which basically says that you are running under the consent of the logged in user. Or you can use the delegated permissions, and that's what we're going to use, because the delegated permissions have some sort of admin. It's a service account, so they have admin permissions and then have more permissions to create things in your Azure AD tenant. And for this, we want to create a Azure AD B2B user, and we need more admin permissions for this, so we need to set delegated permissions for this. It uses the Microsoft Graph. And for those who don't know what the Microsoft Graph really is, it's basically the API to connect to all sorts of resources inside of Azure. You can use it to connect to system devices. It's also used for Office 365 resources, like SharePoint Online or OneDrive, or all sorts of resources in there to access documents, to set permissions on documents. And it also gives you insights. So you can connect to different insight resources as well in there. So before we register that application, let's just take a look at the basic flow. First, the client application will make a request to the login service of Microsoft, and you will put in that request the application ID and the secret. So you're basically going to call out to Azure AD with that application credentials, and you say, give me an access token to connect to the different services. So that's the first step. Azure AD will give you that access token, will return you that access token, and then the next step will be to use that access token to make a request to the Graph API, and this one, in this case, this will be the Invitations API to create an external user. We have set the permissions to access that API. So with that access token, we create that external user, and we get a response back that or the user is created, or there was some sort of error, or maybe not authorized, or not the right delegated permissions, or something like that. So that's the basic flow which Azure uses, which OAuth 2.0 uses to create, to access that API and create your resources. So let's take a look at that registration. So we go back to our Azure portal. Okay, go to the home page of the Azure portal again, and then we go to Azure Active Directory. And then we go to app registrations to register an app. Okay, let's go to all applications for this. And I've created a secure serverless application to get permissions to the Azure AD B2B tenant. And for that, when you registered your application, then you have to go to API and permissions to set the right permissions. And in here, you can add the permissions. So you click on add a permission. By default, only the user.read is selected. But we need to add some other permissions to it as well. So you click on add permission, then click on Microsoft Graph. And here you can select or the delegated application or the application permissions. So click on application permissions. And to connect to that Azure AD or to your Azure AD B2B tenant, you have to select the directory read-write all. And at last, the user read-write all. So these are the permissions that are needed to create users inside your Azure AD B2B tenant. Click add permission. And then you have to grant admin consent for this. So that's the next step. If you use application permissions, you have to take this step. And as an administrator, you have to give access to that application. So that's an extra step that you need to take before the application has the actual permissions. Okay, after that, we need to create a secret, generate a secret, because we use that application secret in our value as well. So you create a new application secret in here. You give it a description and when you want it to expire, and add that application secret. Copy it immediately because it's only going to be shown once to you. So copy it to Notepad. If you forgot that step, you need to generate a new key again. Okay, so now we have our application in place. We can now add these values to our key vault because we want to secure these values and we want to retrieve these values without using any keys and code for it. So let's go back to our resource group. Wait. Okay, let's go back to the key vault. And if you then go to secrets, you will see that I added three secrets to this. And you basically give that secret a name and you give the value to it and you need to enable it. So that's basically it. I copied in the application ID, the tenant ID, the Azure AD tenant ID, and the app secret that we just generated. So now we can use this in our Logic app. We have our managed identity to access this, so we can use this right now. So let's go back to our Logic app. and edit it again. Okay, so let's go a bit down. In here you see that I retrieved that tenant ID and that app ID and that app secret. And there is a bit of a thing. Logic App comes with out-of-the-box connectors to the Key Vault, but you can't use a managed identity for this. That's not in there yet. So if you want to use a managed identity to connect to your Key Vault, you just have to create a basic HTTP request for it. So that's why I don't use that out-of-the-box connectors. So first, you call the Key Vault by URL and by providing the name of the secret. You use that managed identity, the managed identity for this, form your logic app, and your audience needs to be filled in as well, which is always vault.azure.net. So we do exactly the same for the other values, and then we add that value to our parameter initialization. And as you can see, there's a small lock in this, and that means that this value is secured because I've enabled a setting for this. So if you want to secure this value and you don't want to show these values in your logs, you have to go to settings on your variables. Oh, no. It should be settings, but I think something is wrong. But if you go to settings, when you create, where you initialize this, value, maybe in the previous step, wait. Yeah, it's here, sorry. Okay, so when you retrieve that value, you have to go to the settings from your HTTP request, and in here you can enable secure outputs. So now this value is secured, and it will not show up in logging or any other in any other code or monitoring solution. Okay? So we now have our app secret, we have our app ID, and we have our tenant ID retrieved from our Azure Key Vault. And now we have to generate the access token from Azure AD. We need to call in to the login page from Azure AD and get an access retoken in return. So you do that by posting a request to login.microsoftonline.com. You add your tenant ID to it, and then you request that token. And in the body, you add the app ID and the client secret, and you pass on the microsoft.graph.com resource. So when you run this, you will get a response back, and in that response is also the access token, like you can see in here. Then we use that access token again, and we reach out to the invitations API, which is the API to create our external user. We set a redirect URL for this as well, so when the user gets their invitation, the external user gets their invitation in their inbox, and they click on that button, and they log in to your Azure AD tenant, basically, then it will be redirected to the myapps.microsoft.com page in this scenario. You can also add a different URI to this. Maybe you want to redirect your user to a custom application or maybe to a SharePoint site. So in here you can set that value. You can't do this when you create Azure B2B users in the Azure portal. Then it will always be the default one, the myapps.microsoft.com page. So what we basically do, we create a user display name, and we use the first name and the last name for this. We add the email address for the external user, and we create a body which will be added to that email as well, the invitation email. And that's basically it. We want to send the invitation message as well. You can also disable this so that your users will not get an invitation email but will be added to your tenant. And that's basically it. Save your logic app, and now we can create our external users. What I didn't do in this, and that's one thing to note, I did not remove the queue message because I want to generate some traffic for my logging capabilities. But if you're creating this one yourself, you have to manually delete that queue message after you retrieve the values. Otherwise, it's going to run every 3 minutes and goes on and on and on. Okay? So what we basically did, we registered that Azure ID application. We added the tenant ID, the app ID, and the secret to the key vault. We then retrieved those values in our logic apps by using our managed identity and a HTTP request. We generated an access token by providing those values, and we retrieved that access token from Azure AD. And then we use that values to create the external user in Azure AD. So now for the last step, we have our solution. We have a working solution, but we need some monitoring capabilities to it as well. Because you definitely want to know if people are going to access your application without being authenticated or by trying out different usernames or email addresses. So you want to know, you need to know what's actually going on inside of your application. So you can use three different resources for this. You start with Application Insights, and this one you need to manually enable when you create your function. Here you can put in your application code logging. Then your logic app can use log analytics for it. So basically all Azure resources use log analytics to log their information to a workspace. And what you can do to retrieve those values and to create metrics and create alerts and combine these values with other types of loggings, you use Azure Monitor. Basically all monitoring goes into Azure Monitor nowadays. If it is infrastructure monitoring or code application monitoring, we all use Azure Monitor for this. So that Application Insights is basically a DLL that you can use inside of your code. And you can use it in all sorts of applications. Applications that are hosted in Azure, but maybe applications that are not hosted in Azure. You can use it for all types of applications. It automatically logs basic information to Application Insights, and you can create your own logging information like I did in my Azure function when I used log.information. You can also create your own logging for it. It has all sorts of mechanisms in it. You can create a Power BI dashboard with an overview of your monitoring, but you can also use that values inside of Visual Studio as well. It's integrated in there. And you can create alerting in it. So a very comprehensive solution if you need logging for your applications. The other one, Log Analytics, used by Azure Resources. It has a separate workspace where all data is logged. It's also a best practice to create separate workspaces for your different environments, one for development, one for acceptance, and one for production as well. It's fully integrated in Azure Monitor, and I will show you that in the later demo. It uses KQL, the Kusta Query Language, and basically all monitoring solutions in Azure are using that language. If you look at Azure Sentinel, it also uses KQL. So it's really recommend to learn that language. It has a bit of a, it's quite difficult to get into it, but it's definitely worth it. Okay, Azure Monitor, the monitoring solution. Are there people already using Azure Monitor for their, okay, 2, 3? Okay, not that many. All monitoring from all solutions inside of Azure are going to show up in Azure Monitor. You can also use it for external applications. You can also connect to external or a hybrid application or on-premises application. You can integrate it with all sorts of services. You can use Power BI dashboard for it. You can create views inside of the Azure portal, and you can enable those views for particular users, for instance, or maybe for development groups. You can also use it for network monitoring or maybe for IP monitoring. It's all in there. So let's take a look at the different capabilities. And I'll briefly show you this. Okay, what we actually did in the first step, we already looked a bit at the monitoring, but just directly from the Azure function. But now let's go to Azure Monitor. And as you can see, you can get all different sort of insights for your databases, your Cosmos DB, for your networking, containers, and for your application. So this is basically now going to show up the application insights. And I created a secure serverless log when I created my function. So if you select this one, you go to the dashboard and you will see some basic information from the overview page directly. You can also click on application map. You see that I have one call in the last hour, and it went directly to my message queue. So you can see an application map of all the different applications that are used inside of this analytics. You can also do a live metric stream in here. So if you run that function or that function is running in production, you can also see the logging coming in live with no delay at all. And it's basically the same logging as I showed in the monitoring step from the function. You can create metrics and alerts. You can also use the Kusto query language in here as well to create your own queries and to create your own dashboards for it. So it has a lot of capabilities. So now let's take a look at the other one, the application insights. And this is when you also, you can enable this from inside Azure Monitor, but you have to select the more button in here. So it's not in the list. It automatically opens my secure serverless workspace that I created when I created my Logic app. So this one has my Logic app information in it. As you can see, 45 runs, none filled. You can click on this, and now you go deeper inside of your logging workspace. And when there are values in here, you will see them. I don't have any values at the moment. But if you go back to your overview, to your monitor overview page, wait, no, back. And you select logs in here. Then you will see that you can also create your own queries in here. Like for instance, this one. Get the 50, limited 50. Azure metrics, and you will see create external user, the metric name. So it logs different metrics in here. Like action succeeded, run completed. So you can dive into your logging experience in here. What you can also do, and I'll show this briefly for the sake of time, is create an alert from here. So let's go to our logs again. No, it's not here. Go to our applications. Go to our application insights. You can also create an alert for your... So let's say a user is trying to access our Azure function, trying to log in with credentials, with the wrong credentials for 100 times, for instance. Then you can add a condition, create an alert and add a condition and say that maybe the HTTP trigger count, I want to count all the triggers and click on done. Need to pass on a value, let's say for 100 times, more than 100 times, click on done. Create an action group for this, so what do you want to, what is the action when the alert goes off? Maybe you want to receive an email for this. So you select the resource group for it. And you add a group name and an action type in here. So now you can see that you have a couple of actions which you can select. Let's say you click email, you provide an email address in here, and you click OK. So now when there are more requests, more than 100 requests to my service, for instance, my administrator or my the guy that from whom the email address is added will receive an alert. So you can secure or monitor based on security standards and requirements from here as well. Okay. So we looked at the Azure Monitor capabilities, we looked at Application Insights and at Log Analytics, which you can use to secure and add an extra layer of monitoring and security on top of your solutions. So what we basically did, we now created a secure application to create external users inside of Azure AD, which has all the requirements in place that were needed for our security department. So a wrap up, there is one thing with the Azure functions when you use the authentication authorization, and it's the V1 endpoint that is used. What I tried to do is created a client secret, generated a client secret when I created the application. But when I tried to access it by, I got an access token back from Azure AD, but when I tried to create that user using that access token, I always got a 401, unauthorized. So you can't use the Azure AD V2 endpoint when you enable that Azure AD authentication on it. So that's one thing to note. What I think is that if you enabled it on the app service plan, so if you use a different service plan, not the consumption one, then you can enable it on a different level, and I guess that you can use the V2 endpoint for then as well for it. Okay, don't forget that your Azure function needs to be configured for anonymous access, because otherwise you need that SAS token. And at last, and I already told that, the out-of-the-box connector for Key Vault doesn't support managed identities. So thanks. Are there any questions? Yeah?
In the logic app, you set it to run under a managed identity.
Yeah.
And you created a separate app registration to access Azure AD.
Yes, that's right.
Can the managed identity not be given permissions directly to access Azure?
That was an option if you add extra permissions to it, but we only wanted that managed identity to access the message queue and not use that same managed identity to access the graph as well. So for this scenario, I've created two separate ones. Any other questions? No? Okay, thank you. Enjoy the rest of your conference.